But one rarely knows how companies use it, and I think many times companies themselves don't know how to use data from different touch points to make it, you know, or to create it or use it for useful insights into, you know, into consumer behavior and something that you can really use. So that's what we're going to talk about today, data mining. And the session is called How to Transform Data into Data from Multiple Touchpoints into Consumer Insights that you can really use. So, you know, I haven't really said anything very different. People who are going to come on stage next are people who know this space very, very well. I'd like to request Ashok Desikan, Business Head, Retail Tyco, to please come on stage. Mr. Rohan Deshpande, CTO, Ogilvy and Mehta. Mr. Venkat Krishna, V, Global Practice Leader, Retail ITC Infotech. Mr. Vikas Chaudhary, COO and CFO, India IMA. Vikrant Podar, Head IT Big Cinemas. Vinod Vidarkopa, Director and IT and Director IT and CIO for Tesco. And our moderator for this session, Mr. Vineet Purushottam, Senior VP, Technology and Logistics for HyperCity. Welcome. And I hand over to you to take this session forward.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. I know you had a very great lunch, and we are going to keep you awake. That's what we try to do. I've got a great set of panel members here, and what I'll do is I'll just start off, and when I talk to each of them, I'll introduce each of them so that everyone is fine there. The topic is, as you started off saying, how I'll begin by saying that when you say for anyone who's in the technology space or in the business space, data when processed is information and is insight. That may sound very elementary. But then that's the whole crux of the thing, yeah, because the complexity only starts happening when the data comes in various forms and sizes, and the volume that we now deal with in terms of the, because of the digital world that we are in. And that continuously makes this process of data mining more and more complex. We also know, as we progress along the panel, we'll see how the various ways data mining is used by various business. We'll try to touch upon some of those areas which we don't want people to do in terms of mining and what they should be doing when they mine data. How they ensure that data, which is the most important bit of this, is good. Otherwise, we'll get into a garbage in and garbage out. So we'll try to touch upon all these pieces and slowly come towards the end. We'll try to keep 15 minutes for all of you to ask questions to this great panel. So from now, start with Vinod. Vinod is from Tesco, and he's the Director of IT and the CIO. Vinod, can start off by telling us how has Tesco, we all know Tesco does a lot of data mining and analytics. How has Tesco over a period of time worked with the customer data and the sales data and other things that you have, and how has it helped your company do well in terms of working on analytics?
Thank you, Vineet. And so briefly, I just want to talk a little bit about Tesco and technology and getting on the topic itself. So my role is to really lead the worldwide technology operations for Tesco of India. And as you all know, we have about, probably some of you know, we have about 7,000 stores worldwide, you know, across UK, Central Eastern Europe, and Asia. So a lot of it for us, actually, the way we drive the business depends on how well we use the data. Just to give you a feel for the data, we have about 77 million Flipkart customers. We drive roughly about 160 million transactions per day just in the UK alone. We have close to 50,000 tills just in the UK alone. And the reason I bring this out is no human by himself or herself can actually make any sense of how to drive the business if we don't really have a very sound technology strategy that drives and enables the business. So our CEO now says technology is a new property, right? And gone are those days when, you know, we had the retailers in a race to put bigger, badder stores 50,000, 80,000, 100,000 square foot large format stores. I think where the world is going, and I think that's very relevant to India from as well, from the conversations we heard from yesterday, where you know we don't have the ability to put a billion square foot of stores in the next 8 to 10 years. So if you start looking at you know the some of the different areas where data makes sense for us, and we have divided that into three distinct pillars, if you will, where data allows us to engage with the customer, where data allows us to empower our internal stakeholders, so the people like in the depots, the stores, the merchandising officers, the merchandising directors, and so on. And lastly, you know, how do we actually evolve with all the sales data and some of the other data that we collect from the different touch points that we have. So let me take a simple example. From the customer perspective, we use a sister concern of ours, which is called Dunhambi, to do a lot of analysis of the data that we gather. So if you look at the stack, right, so you've got the data, the information, the knowledge, and the wisdom. So it's at the very lowest level, it's just about capturing the data from the different disparate sources. Then you have, you know, how do you bring that data and put it in a data warehouse and some of the basic fundamental blocking and tackling things, as I would call it. Then you actually have some level of reporting on top of that data. Then as you mature, as the organization matures, then you need to drive, you know, what in the classical terminology is called analytics, right? Insight, foresight, you know, predictive analytics, and so on. So what Dunhambi allows us to do, at least on the engage the customer part side of it, we take all the data from our skills and from all the customer facing touch points, and we look at segment the customer data. So one example is in the UK we had the mothers of young families coming into the store and shopping for everything related to health and beauty. And one of the insights of the data that came out from this analytics was they would not shop for baby products, right? In spite of us having a full range of baby products. So the next thing for us to do was to use this information, I get a piece of information, and understand why is it that the young mothers, or parents, I should call, are not using the available you know, baby products in the store. So we started a close engagement process with the moms. We called it the baby club. We introduced some very friendly programs with the mothers, and there was no minimum qualifying criteria for this. And then subsequently, we actually allowed them. We brought in the touch points where, as the mom progresses with her pregnancy, you know, with the life stage of the baby's development, getting the right products, the right information, I would say, information at the right time. So in about a year's time, the end result of it was we could get a translation of about 40 million additional incremental spend from just from the moms in the baby club compared to the peer group. So that's one very top of my head example of how analytics could drive and help your business. Let me stop there.
Yeah, thank you. Vinod did mention about a lot of things that they've done. So that brings me to the next part of that particular of the discussion, saying when there's so much at stake in terms of information, and there's so much that you want to do with the information that baby club and so on, capturing of the data becomes all the more important. It's very important that the first contact that you have with the customer, how much are you able to capture, and how well are you able to capture it. Vikrant is the head IT from Big Cinemas. Vikrant, if you can just tell us, for me, the first point of capture is when you first meet the customer, and how much of information do you think you, in your experience, have been able to capture, and how much of this information is captured well, because that becomes very important for the further analysis and everything to be done, right?
See, basically what we are talking about is data. Now, this data could be in multiple methods. One is pure data that someone types in. Another is the mode of payment that the person makes. Another point which I feel which we can also elaborate on data mining is the person who's standing at the till can gather a lot of information at the end of the day, because he's someone who is physically talking to our patrons, our consumers. There is a behavioral pattern and there is a dialogue engage that happens in between that person and the consumer who's standing across the counter. If we could leverage that kind of or we could leverage a program wherein, you know, that input also comes as a part of our data mining or part of our data and adds to our mind, it can give substantial information as in exactly what does the consumer want and what does he like. Now, along with this, we were also discussing that when you churn the ocean, there is nectar and there is poison also going to come out, and someone has to consume poison. I'm sure whenever there is a feedback, everyone would love to have a positive feedback that I am looking good, he's looking good, she's looking good. But at the end of the day, if someone comes and tells you that, hey, this dress doesn't suit you, how well is the feedback taken? I would say by the management, by the people, or by the person, by the department who actually is getting this feedback and turn it around. Say, everyone knows, like at the end of the day, whatever we are doing fine is fine, we can do it better. But there is some portion in our data which can give this kind of a feedback as well. I'm not saying that this is the feedback, but yes, if we can leverage on that. I'm sure Rohan also has something to add on this, because he is someone who creates the interface for a technology person like me and the end consumer when he does activities. Obviously, there is someone more who can add on to this. But at the end of the day, I am a person who enables my company to collect data. I don't mine, I just mine it. I don't analyze it. It is people like him who help mine the data.
Yeah. So you're saying it's important that the process is good, otherwise the data that comes is bad. And you're saying it's also important that the final output that comes out, the business should be able to take it positively and use it.
Right.
Yeah. So if I may go on to Venkat now, for now, because Venkat is from ITC, and Venkat, you in your case, you also tell us about your eChopal story and how difficult it was to capture data when you are that far.
Actually, I am from ITC Infotech. ITC Infotech is a 100% subsidiary of ITC, and we work with both ITC and non-ITC customers as well. So, when I talk about eChopal and Chopal Sagar, the problems are at a very, very fundamental level, you know, because, you know, we are talking about hinterland where the basic infrastructure is not in place, you know. Our stores get power maybe for about 8 to 10 hours, so I need to have alternate sources of power to run my IT systems, to run my security systems. When we started in the late 90s, there's no connectivity, so we had to put up our own VSATs. Now it has improved. So there are challenges in terms of running your basic infrastructure, but things have been improving continuously, and you know. So we now talked about you know, a lot of data. You know, insights can be drawn from it, and sometimes it is difficult, sometimes it's easy, and you know. I want to share you know, a couple of examples of,
please,
you know, these are very simple examples, you know, how simple data can be looked at and meaningful insights can be drawn. So this is the, you know, very recent work we have done with one of the specialty retailers based out of UK. You know, the context was they had a loyalty system, and they are planning to upgrade their loyalty system. And then they thought that, well, I upgrade the loyalty system, but actually what is my customer experience management strategy? You know, what is my vision? What is my roadmap? Then, you know, we moved on and now we have, opportunities to look at customers at a micro level. All along we have been having one offer for all the customers. So, you know, can we move on from one offer to all the customers to targeted offers? You know, can I work with different segments of customers to offer them what is of relevance to them? So we looked at POS data. So from a source of data, it's only POS data. So POS data in reference to customers. So they have about 5 million loyalty customer base. So we took data for about 12 months. So we took 12 months data because it cuts down all the seasonality impact. So if we have 12 months data, then you know the first criteria is how do you segment them based on the need? In the sense like why does he come to me? Does he come to me by sport nutrition? Does he come to me by natural food? Does he come to me by some other type of product? So basically what is the need? I would like to understand and segment them based on the need. So based on their relative share of products in the bill they buy. So we segmented them into n number of segments. So going by pure statistical way, you get about 60 segments. So from an execution point of view, can you handle 60 segments? So obviously you can't handle 60 segments. So you have to use their business knowledge to bring them and make it to manageable number of clusters, maybe 5, 6, 7, whatever works for you. And on top of it, you can put another layer of segmentation of RFM based on how frequently he comes to me, how recently he came to me, what is his total spend on me. So there are ways where you can do complex analysis, there are ways where you can do simple analysis leading to meaningful results. So I have some more examples.
Yeah, we'll come to that as we go. We also see a lot of advertisers now getting into this space. I've read somewhere where to just get more money out of the budget that they already have, each of the companies are spending more on the data mining. So there are examples of insurance agencies now looking into your buying pattern of and how healthy food that you buy just before they come back and give you some kind of insurance. So there was a joke around where one of the data mining agency, an employer for data mining agency, the guy never bought his junk food using his credit card, because if he bought his junk food using credit cards, he would be tracked and his insurance premium would go up. So Rohan, if you can tell us a little about how some of these data that you work for your clients, and what are some of the interesting things that you guys have done in data mining?
Thanks, Vinny. Firstly, I'm the odd one out here. I'm the only advertising agency guy out here amongst all the retail.
Many of them out there, I can see.
No, but the typical, as a first question as you asked, what is an advertising guy doing here? No? But literally, today the ad agencies itself, us, like for example, Ogilvy and Mather, O&M, we are into data. We are also part of this world. Reason being, what we do is finally based on what Venkat said or what Vinod said or what all of these guys said. The outcome is basically creating a brand value and going out and creating advertising, be it print advertising or television or digital, is what we do. So we are now already integrated into this piece with the brands which we work with, and actually have started a practice of data analytics and data mining and data analytics out of India to help a lot of our international, not so of Indian clients so far, but a lot of our international clients based out of, so one of them is a largest retail provider in North America for whom we do all the data analytics and data mining out of India. And the idea here is not to, obviously to help them with all the points which these guys, these gentlemen mentioned, but also to provide them with an advertising solution at the end of the day, to tell them that what is it which will help them or help their consumers have a brand recall. While everybody talks about digital technology, etc., at the end of the day, what matters to a brand is how big the brand is and how he can push the brand in front of the consumer when that fellow is buying. Today, I mean, if you look at data mining per se, if I look at just doing data aggregation and data mining, today you do it through various methods. One is for doing it for research. Second, you do it for driving sales. Third, you drive it or do it for CRM loyalty. But at the end of the day, overall, the overall picture is for driving the brand in terms of all of these aspects. And that's what we help the brands enable, or that's what we enable for the brands going forward. And this is across these parts.
Is there any examples that you can tell us? I mean, of how you build the brand for a particular company?
Yes, sure, definitely. One thing which I wanted to touch upon, which he mentioned about e-Chopals and rural. I mean, everybody talks about, when you're talking about India, rural being the largest segment or the untapped segment. And that is a fact. I mean, for example, we do rural marketing today for one of the largest FMCG companies worldwide. And we do that practice for them in India as well. And we reach out to about 80,000 villages in a year. That's 80,000 villages in 365 days. With that, we basically, the guys on ground have to find out what is the kind of, so how many retailers are there, what is the stocks they keep, what is it which they push in front of their consumers, what is the branding which is available, all of that. So all of that is as an information. Today we've enabled all these guys on foot with Android phones and mobile connectivity with GPRS to capture photos and all this data to be clubbed onto a single platform, which is then made available to the brand to help them with basically to find out what is the supply chain. So how basically from the distance of from the main highway of those retailer of those towns, basically they can plan the supply chain, they can plan in terms of what needs to go where, how they need to push marketing in those particular villages where their brand is not being seen, etc. So today data has come out to be in a way wherein, yeah, this using data, as I said, it's not humanly possible to go through all of this. Using data and insights, you create the advertising, you create the front end to reach out to your prospective consumer and try and push sales at the end of the day.
Yeah, thanks. Ashok, your company works with a lot of retailers in helping them get some of these data, right? Can you guys tell us, I mean, how do you help companies capture data, sales data as well as payment data? And because I'm still touching upon the data aspect, because I still feel that's very important, how you capture the data.
Thanks, Vinit. Saying that you feel odd to be in this panel. When I got the topic, I felt I was the odd man out in the entire topic. Then I realized, you know, we currently play the role of creating the data. You know, we're neither in the mining space nor in the analytics space at this point in time. We help to leverage on the technologies to create the data. And as more and more people get into the analytics of the data, the most visible way that we could see people getting into data analytics is, or the most visible space is the video analytics. You know,
if you can just tell people here, you work for Tyco,
yeah,
and what does Tyco do? Because
okay. Thanks, Vinit. I represent Tyco, the retail division of Tyco, and I've been working on Indian retail space for the last 11-12 years. Got connected to this industry by selling credit card terminals, which probably was the first automation that happened in a retail space. Okay, so as more and more people get into analyzing the data in retail, there is a more and more expectation from the already deployed technologies or solutions to get more and more data. For example, I know as mature retailers moving into understanding the store level efficiencies, people want to know how many people, how at what hour of the day, how much is traffic flowing into my store? How do I get an in and out count? At any point, a given point in time, how many, or at the end of the day, how many of them paid by cash? How many of them paid by credit card? Okay, if five people in a family walk in and one guy is paying, so I know I'm catering to a family crowd. So data providing has become as critical as the base foundation for us at this point in time. There are requests from various retailers. Can I get to know that if somebody walks into my store, how many of them walk to the right, how many of them walk to the left? The same data which was used only for loyalty at some point in time is now required by the marketing team, it's required by the visual merchandising team. So, we play in the space of creating the data. There are hundreds of examples that we could give. But as we were discussing in the afternoon, data is something, if we need to understand what is good data, what is bad data, how do I slice the data, but as long as we look at it with the end result in mind and stay focused to using the data for getting to the end result, are we analyzing the data for getting to know the customer experience and stay focused to it, data is definitely the best indicator for any of the customer.
Thank you. As retailers and as companies, like we discussed, continue to have a lot of data, you go about investing a lot in technology subsequently to get more analytics and information out of this data. What we see people face as we go invest in technology, we soon realize that the people within, the associates, or the people that you need to work on this data are difficult to find. If you find them, it's difficult to retain them because there's not enough exciting happening within your company. That's when people look out for help. And a lot of agencies, like you mentioned, Dun & Bradstreet, and a lot of other agencies, there's another panelist who's supposed to join us from Sequity. So there are a lot of people out there who are now ready to come in and help customers, help retailers, and a lot of us with our data, with help us analysis. The importance here is that you need to have people who understand your business, at the same time understand statistics and how to play with data. If I can come to you, because Aymar, how do you see how do you see this trend moving out, and how do you work with customers? One question that I want to ask you, your views here is, as a client comes to you, there's a good reason, good possibility that they'll be worried about what you do with those insights. Will it be shared with anybody else? How confidential is the data and the insights?
Sure. So let me give you a quick background, so with context. And Vikram mentioned that data can be nectar or poison. So we are nectar. So I work for this company called INEA, which runs one of the world's largest coalition programs in several countries called nectar. So we believe data is nectar. And data is what our business is completely built on. Like most businesses treat their assets and their confidentiality, our entire business treats data with that same level of privacy and seriousness. To give you an idea of scale and size, we deal with over 200 million households every year. We have over 200 billion transactions that we record on our systems. And we issue about $2 billion worth of rewards every year. All of these across 20 different countries. And we touch about, serve about 100 of the Fortune 500 retailers around the world. So it includes, if you take some examples, Coke and Pepsi, it includes Unilever and P&G. So we have created processes, systems, technology, people to be able to service seemingly competitive businesses, but being able to very clearly delineate them from each other. And I think this ecosystem actually is now formed in most of the service providers that you find around the world. So most of the large consulting companies that you have who serve to different
customers in the same industry and be still able to maintain the difference. The way we do it essentially is that you obviously do not share information, intelligence, data, people across competitive brands.
Are there separate teams then? For each of these companies, do you have separate teams?
We do have separate teams for the brands. There are markets in which, like in Canada, we run loyalty programs for 4 out of 5 top banks in Canada. In India itself, we run Axis Bank as well as Standard Chartered Bank. We do have completely different teams that work with them. Our systems are different, so the data doesn't talk to each other. What's also important to understand is the context that in today's industry, there is no one-size-fits-all. So I can't actually copy-paste solution that I made for Axis Bank and actually put it towards Standard Chartered Bank. Right? The customer is different, the market is different, the products are different. So I actually first craft a solution by understanding the business of my customer well and my customer's customers well. And then, of course, in terms of hygiene, I do maintain different teams, different data, different systems that go out and that go on.
Great, thank you. One of the things that we continued to discuss was that the data was more, whenever we talked about data, it was about customer data and sales data. Sales data, we all know that beyond the sales data also tells you more about your inventory, your product, how they are laid out in the store and so on. You know, if you can tell us what more can you do in terms of instead of just sticking to the customer analysis of the data, what are the other things a retailer can do just with analyzing data?
Well, I think we're all in the business of delighting the customer, and that doesn't necessarily mean that it's at the touch point where the customer is really coming into contact with the products. A lot can be done behind the scenes, and again, I'll go back to an example with Tesco. So one of the very critical systems for us is the store ordering, right? So how do you actually get the best shelf availability with the least wastage and just in time from your disposal or whatever you get directly from the source? So we have about 50 guys just working on this continuously on this algorithm, trying to fine tune this and getting the best insights out of that. So that we have the ability to bring product just in time and have that the best mathematical model, not an arithmetic model where we just throw some safety stock out there and just hope that we won't displease the customer, because with the margin levels that we all have as retailers in our business, every single small thing that we do in our supply chain or the value chain of our processes really helps the end customer. So having that availability, having the least waste, it makes a lot of sense for us in terms of store ordering. So I think this is one other area where mining your data. I mean, we actually scan about 48,000 SKUs every hour, right? Products every hour in every store. So that we are on top of everything that's happening from a sales perspective for any given SKU in any given store, and then we'll try and get exactly what's in there, what's necessary at the right time. The other example that I could use is also to improve customers' experiences is video analytics. So in the store, when you actually have customers walking around, your inventory system will tell you that there is an inventory, but it doesn't tell you, particularly on the grocery side, right? I mean, I don't like to walk in and see just 2 broccoli heads or 3 broccoli heads in the basket. So I'd rather have you a minimum half full, so I know that that we are paying attention and getting the fresh food in time, and it's always available for me. So we use video analytics for in places where just track some of this stuff and make sure that is it fully empty, half full, or completely full, and make sure it gets replenished in time. There are also some things that we've consciously stayed away from. I mean, today, video analytics gives us the ability to facial recognition, so technology exists today so that we can actually capture every single person that walks into your store, and if that person is your loyal Club Card member, then you actually can put a board and say, welcome Mr. X or welcome Ms. Y. But I don't think we want to make the customer uncomfortable and then letting him or her know that we know every minute detail of their life. So I think there are some ethical decisions, moral decisions that us there's the stewardship, there's the guardianship of the data. So we have an enormous amount of data, and then like you were saying, some of this could sometimes be poison, some of the times it could be a data that I or my family members may not want to do. Right, so that's some area that I think we still have to get better at. Because we put machines to throw out insights, sometimes it throws out some dangerous insights.
Taking it ahead from what he said, basically, we are talking about only our consumers, our customers. But as a technology team which is sitting here, we have not our consumers, but we have our customers, which we call the internal customers. And using some data points, like say for example, let me check out a CCTV. Say if our housekeeping department looks at the CCTV, just not from the security angle, but to also check if one, the employees are working fine, secondly, what are the areas that are continuously getting dirty so that something can be done about it, probably deploy an extra housekeeping guy or keep a bin or something of that sort. The marketing team can also analyze as to, you know, what is the time when actually consumers are walking in, what is the time and everything. The operations department can figure out which aisle has maximum footfall, which aisle doesn't have a maximum footfall, how do we can stock items. We were discussing something in the morning, and I always have this question in my mind that whenever I go to a superstore, why is it that the men's department, the women's department, the kids department are stocked separately? Say today if my wife is checking out on a dress, and if there is an aisle which has a jeans counter, I'll go and check out a jeans for myself. I guess you will be able to answer in a better manner. So because what happens is when she is shopping, I am standing dumb. When I am shopping, she is standing dumb because she has nothing to do. What is she going to check out on her shirt? Probably she will just wait for me to select a couple of more shirts and then, okay fine, this looks better. That's about it. But if there is an aisle which also has her stuff, by all means, and the internal competition, she will end up buying something for herself if I am buying something for myself. He or you probably, since you do a lot of data analysis, probably can answer me.
I was actually going to add another dimension to this entire discussion. So we are constantly talking about doing data analysis on transactional data. Talking about and what other data sources can be really used to be able to derive insight that you spoke about right now, saying, you know, I want to place jeans next to Sarah, for example. How do I really get that other than transactional market basket data, for example? So I wanted to just throw something out there where when we look at data, we actually believe that today interactions count as much, if not more, than transactions. So what do I mean by that? It means that you don't necessarily only have to look at your sales and invoice data and what people are buying to be able to decide and then use for predictive analysis as to what they would come out and do. Today, there is a lot of data which is sitting out there, which is in the form of interactions. And we believe a lot of pre-purchase data and post-purchase data actually tell you what's going on or what might go on in the purchase cycle. So to give you simple examples that we do in everyday life and the way we look at it is, pre-purchase data is something as simple as going on to Facebook and liking a page. So think about it, when you go and let me take a simple example, whether you like a Harley Davidson or a Bajaj Auto, or if you like a Sridevi or a Poonam Pandey, right? You're conveying a message. You're saying something out there. You're saying, this is what I'm looking for. What you're implicitly actually doing by hitting that like on that page is you're actually building loyalty. You're saying, you know, I want to hear more from this person. That person's, you know, wall news is now coming on your wall, right? So you're giving them the authority to talk to you. So that's pre-purchase data. And if I go and every time you sign on to an app and they pull your Facebook data, remember they can see all this, right? So you're actually telling them about what you're looking for and what you're doing. Give you an example of post-purchase data. Again, something very simple from everyday life. A lot of us use, let's say, an iPhone or a BlackBerry, and every time you send a message out, an email out, right, it just says, "Send from my iPhone, send from my BlackBerry." To me, that is building loyalty. That is actually giving free referrals for your iPhone and for your BlackBerry that you've gone out and bought, right? That is post-purchase data. So does that elicit a network effect? Does that elicit an aspiration in the hands of the recipient when he actually gets that? When the iPhone was first launched, I know a lot of us were very happy that it went and said, "Send from my iPhone," say, "Oh, this guy's got an iPhone." And then the iPad came out saying, "Are you to what take right?" You know, the iPad bhi nahi kind of thing. So that's post-purchase data. That's very interesting. And let me give you finally an example how we've applied some of this in our business. So in the UK, in the Nectar program, what we do is something very interesting. We analyze data at Sainsbury's, which is like Tesco, another large grocer in the UK. So we looked at a particular segment. So we looked at middle-aged health-conscious buyers, right? Some of us might identify ourselves in that category. Some of us might not want to call ourselves middle-aged, but nevertheless, we looked at their buyer behavior in the store. So they said, okay, they are going out and buying, let's say, these protein shakes, or they're going and buying these organic juices, and so forth. We then went in and looked at that set of people, what their online behavior was. Because we actually have a tie-up with Yahoo, where you actually get points for searching using the Yahoo toolbar instead of using Google in the UK, right? So we went and looked at their search behavior, and we looked at whatever they were looking for. Let's say the most important question that a lot of us ask is, should I buy an iPhone or a Samsung Galaxy 4? Right? So we looked at their behavior. Then what we did is we looked at other people on the internet who are searching for similar things. What is their behavior online? Then we said, so these people probably resemble these sorts of people in their offline behavior as well. And we then sent them offers. These online people who mirrored these, sent these offers every time they walked into a Sainsbury store and swiped their card on the till, saying, "Hey, we have this special deal on these products for you in the health and wellness categories." And I actually saw a significant response rate in double digits of actually taking up those offers. So how do you connect all these various data sources, which is another example I wanted to share of how you look at data and what's happening in the world out there.
Yeah, so there's a lot of external data sources I know about.
One thing I would want to ask Rohan, you are a brand guy, you work for brands. Today in the morning, as we were discussing, say for example, there is a vehicle brand with you, there is an oil brand with you, and there is a tire brand with you. Anyone who is buying the vehicle will end up buying oil and a tire at one point of time. Do brands consider doing these cross promotions? If yes, are they doing it? If no, what is stopping them from doing it?
Okay, let me start from the basics of that. In the advertising world, one agency is not allowed or doesn't handle two competing brands, unlike data marketing or data analytics tools.
So here I'm talking about two separate brands.
Yeah, so one is that. Second, when you're saying you've got a scooter or two-wheeler and an oil company and a servicing brand, three brands, obviously, it's always good to go out and tell them that, yeah, you can combine, and we obviously advise them in terms of doing it, but they prefer to do they don't prefer to do this. The reason which I feel, or which you would also agree with, is they prefer to do their branding alone. They would like their own brand to stand out, and they would like to go out into the market and push out their own brands. While we can churn out all this data, as you've said, or as these guys have said, you can get a cross-promoted data, and obviously the combined power of selling or reaching out to this, because the end consumers are all overlapping at the end of the day. This guy who's bought a two-wheeler or a car or a truck will obviously need that oil at some point, and probably needs to replace his tires at some point. So the data is again overlapping. But it's similar to, I would say, a multi-brand retail, coming back to Vinay. He's got multiple retailers within himself. Whether he can go out, whether he wants to push Hypercity or whether he wants to push a particular brand, that is the key question. And from what I've seen, I don't think brands would want to do that.
Yeah, it'll be a call which each of the brands will want to take on their own, so it's not very easy for retailers to push that. Now, we have a lot of other things that we could go on talking about. We also had planned to touch upon the thin line of privacy, which I guess to an extent Vinod did mention. To what extent can you, because with the kind of data now that's out there about yourself, you'll not realize somebody else knows more about you than you yourselves. So it has to be very, very careful now. So the people are really skeptical about the kind of data that anybody uses. So there's a very thin line there. I would have loved to have a discussion on that line also, but then I guess we are out of time. So I'll just leave 10 minutes for the audience to take questions before we wind up. Anyone wanting to have a discussion? Gentleman there? Can we have mics here, please? Second row. Can you please hold the mic closer to you?
In fact, this is not a question to all of you. There was a time when my friend told me I want to buy a watch, and I tried to search Google and all the places to find out a watch. And just to recommend him that this is the right watch, you should buy. But what ended up is till now also, I received some promotion or something like that, which says that you have to buy this watch or that watch, or this is the offer on this watch. Now, I'm not interested in watch. But how authentic it is in terms of social analytics when it comes like this? Because till today also, I received a mail from today also, 25% discount on this watch from this vendor or that vendor and all. So they are thinking I am interested in watch, but I am not. But at the same time, the whole the online media is thinking like that.
So if I can answer his question.
Yeah,
so today what technology has done is not just helped in targeting. So earlier it was based on, so as he said, based on buying patterns, one could target you and send out an email saying that you bought this, so you probably want to buy something else as well. Today the technology has moved on to doing retargeting as well. So the way retargeting works is, at least on the online space, is that if you've gone to a clear trip and probably searched for a flight from Bombay to Delhi, you've moved out of that page, you've not bought a flight or you've not done anything, any transaction there, but probably you've gone to a yahoo.com, you will see an ad which says you want to buy rates for Bombay Delhi for these flights are so low. So basically with technology and especially the digital marketing side, getting into, if I want to deep dive, it's cookie-based stuff, something called as cookies, which get dropped onto your browser, which read basically what you've done and basically retarget you for trying to, probably you would want to, you've seen this, probably you would want to buy this as well.
And the two or three things that comes. Yeah.
Basically, what you're saying is that how do you keep the relevance of the data?
Understood.
Because if it's outdated.
So there are two or three things that you're saying. One is that you bought that watch not for yourself. You bought the watch for somebody else. So I could buy an iPad. I could be buying it to gift somebody. Like if the retailer I bought from then thinks that I become a geek and I love devices and keep on pushing devices things on me, it's not going to be exciting for me. So yes, that's one of the data points. So as the amount of attributes that you collect from a customer at the time of transaction could be also helpful to say that did he buy it for himself, did he buy it to gift. So that's one of those. The other bit is we all reach the stage where related to the privacy question that I raised, is that when you get each of these emailers, each of these should definitely have unsubscribe option for the person to say, please don't bombard me with all of these. Right? It's easier said than done. We have a lot of rules in the TRA given us for DND, but we all just continue to get calls. But then yes, it is a measure that should help you. Yeah, thanks.
The last point here which I wanted to do is, he's mentioned, Vikas, that when you go to Facebook and click a like, it basically gives a pattern to what your liking is. Say today if you go and visit a brand watch page two or three more times, Google AdWords and Google Analytics will pick it up, saying that probably you are a watch fan, and the ads will start popping up. It is basically you who has pushed that particular ad to come to you, and data doesn't come automatically. Like, you know, we do not get your email address and start pushing out data to you. You somewhere have mentioned it, that is why it is coming to you.
True, that's another option. He was very clear. He had bought it for somebody else. And the next question.
Yes, sir. Question at the back, please. Mic already. Please go.
Hi, my question is actually pretty simple. You know, currently in the retail format, we operate at the three level, which is like my exclusive store. I have my store in MBOs, and then I have a e-com. When it comes to exclusive store, I get my data ready. When it comes to my multiple brand outlet store, I don't get any source besides my warranty card, which probably has just the SKU number. So how do I manage that? How do I get data from multi-utility or
multi-branded
stores?
I didn't get that.
Okay. I get the three sources. I have shops in three different formats.
Yeah.
One is my e-com, which is like pretty sorted. I know any online entry that comes to me, I get it from there.
Yeah.
Then I have my exclusive brand outlet, where I get my data from, where they fill in the feedback form or they enter, or along with the bill I attach this. But when it happens to the multi-branded stores, which is like a Shoppers or Pantaloons, where I am not the one who's making the bill, so I don't get the data.
Okay. So you're talking yourself as a concessionaire or a shopping shop kind of a person.
Yeah.
So does anyone want to take it?
There is a solution that we deploy outside of India at this point in time. So lots of brands like apparel in multi-brand, or more importantly FMCG brands that sell through retailers, they actually don't get any last mile information in terms of who's bought it and what's going on, and that's very valuable. So we have a solution globally where it's called Code on Pack. It's meant specifically for FMCG brands, where you buy a can of Coke, or if you buy a tube of toothpaste, Colgate, there will be a small serial number and a barcode on that. And if you go online to those websites, actually, they all run loyalty programs, and if you go to those websites and you actually put in that code, that serial number or that can of Coke that you bought, you will actually get rewards and recognition for that in lieu of them, you obviously sharing your information with them. So the takeaway I would have essentially from that is you have to create an engagement with your customer for him to want to interact with you and give you that information to get something back in return. That's the way I would think about it. And then you apply it to your category and your
just in short, you will not get it. I mean, it's not so simple. At the end of the day, the MBO wants to build its own brand and wants to drive that traffic and wants to drive its own loyalty. So it will, at the end of the day, push it. But I know there's one gentleman who can answer your question here within the audience itself, who's more relevant than any of us to answer that question.
Why don't you just get the mic?
Oh. Okay, hi, this is Vinay from Shoppers. Hi, how are you doing? Yeah, so simple, don't get into all this because barcode you're going to send around a chase. Yeah. Simple, we collect the data. Yeah, other retailers also collect the data. We will not give you personal details of the customer. Which brand do you represent? Bagel. Fantastic. So what you could do is, you could engage with the Shoppers Stop direct marketing team who collects this data, okay, who will help you. Because the reason you want this data is you want to communicate to them, you want to increase business, right? You want to increase business with them. We will help you do that without sharing you personal details of the customer, because as you understand, that's a contract between us and the customer. That's probably the one easy way out to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think your basic purpose of wanting this data is to do something with it, right? To use it to maybe generate some insights. Maybe you can check what other products do they buy when they buy a bag, things of that nature. The Shoppers team can help you. We can touch base offline.
There are, I can talk about external agencies also who work on this space. They'll obviously again not give you specific information. There are agencies like Nielsen and others who collect data from most of the retailers and actually work on it.
So we're going to take this off, which is actually brought up a point where you said that you have a contract with a customer. I was just wondering that as organizations, how do you then maintain this data ethically, and how do you manage this data without infringing on privacy and various other gray areas that exist in that zone?
Yes, I was about to just mention there was a slide, one point we discussed there, is that it's not just data that you give to the retailer. You're giving data every time you do anything now. When you're clicking on a like, when you're logging on to any of your websites, and there's no end to it. So you are giving enough data even if you don't go to any retailer in this world. But so that's not the point. The point is each of us are, as retailers and responsible people, will continue to work on. We'll have to work on keeping this data safe. So each of us have the data kept in a way that's not easily accessible. There's a team that works on the loyalty data, right? And most of our cases, even the number is not visible. Somewhere we restrict the contact details from not being seen. There are various ways. Is there anything else?
Yeah, I will just add to that. Actually, from a technology provider perspective, most of this data is masked. Right? So we don't get to see, the teams don't get to see the credit card number, they don't get to see the address details and so on, right? They're only translated at the last point where the actual mailings are sent or the emails are sent out. So I think that there's enough permission within the system which allows us to manage this data. The other example, the other thing that we do is we implemented what's called DLP, data leakage prevention. So we actually track everything that goes out from the colleague, the person who is the team member who's working on a particular workstation. There are things that prevent him or her from taking any data out, either through printouts or through USBs or even through emailing to some of their own personal Yahoo emails, such like that. So I think the industry is at a place where there's a reasonable amount of comfort level, and more than that, for some of us who actually work with the EU and the US, there, by law, I think there's supposed to do this, right? I think there's EU data protection, there is the US data protection laws, and also I think we all need to get comfortable from that sense from the technology provider perspective, data is safe and secure.
One more last point, you mentioned that your company has ethically taken the decision of not sharing this data with anyone, which is more important from a brand perspective. They say, if I have data of 13 lakh emails, or I have a data of 50 lakh or 10 crores or 1 crore users, it is the brand, the person who has the data, like the company which has the data created, has to ethically decide on not to share it with anyone or not to receive it for anything else. Because that is what you say, you can actually figure out that, hey, Mr. X, hey, Mr. Y, you are walking into the store, which you do not want to, because it may have a negative impact.
It's more than ethical, right? I mean, today, I support Tesco Bank. I mean, today, those of you who are conversing with the bank, it's probably 10 times more critical when you have banking data. Right? So I think it's more than ethical. I think by law, we are not all for this. Great.
It's a combination of legal and I think company policies as well as IT support to ensure that all that is then in operation. Anyone who has questions? Yes.
I have a question for Vikas Asse. Vikas, what are your views on a coalition program working in India? The licensing actor, how do you think merchants would or would not embrace such a program in the context of the Indian market? That's what I did here. What we have to understand is that what are the fundamental principles behind coalition programs? And if you design a coalition program keeping in mind those principles that deliver stakeholder value, there will be a market and you will get a buy-in. So let me just talk to you quickly about the three stakeholders involved. So the most important stakeholder is the consumer. If you do a quick poll here, how many people here have, you know, more than 3 loyalty program cards, right? If people could answer all 3 loyalty program cards, a fair number of people, let's say half the people in the audience. How many of them have actually been able to redeem effectively for rewards from the loyalty program card? Right? So I have 6 people in the audience who put their hand up. Fantastic, I'm really happy for you. The problem essentially is that, one, you don't have enough points in individual siloed loyalty programs, but unless you're a gold platinum customer, flies around a lot or buys a lot of groceries, for example. So it's the customer always would choose to pool their points to be able to get a diverse set of rewards availability. It reaches attainability quicker and it gives them a choice of rewards that they want. So let's say I'm a jet platinum customer, I fly every week. Do I want yet another flight ticket to fly at the end of all of that? Probably not. Right? But if you give me something else instead as an option, then give me a phone, maybe I want that. So one is the consumer needs to drive value to the consumer and being able to give him more and better rewards and make the experience much more rewarding to build real loyalty. The second stakeholder is, the most important second stakeholder is the retailer themselves. So by pooling their data with other complementary retailers, so the important point of position or these, you do not have competing retailers in that. Does the retailer benefit? So you say, oh, I'm bringing 3 million of my customers to the party. If 5 other brands that I identify with bring 3 million each, then I will have access to 10, 12 million customers that I couldn't talk to before who now want to listen to me. And can I then monetize that? So can I then drive, use that and drive more cross-sell, upsell acquisition from that base? If you can convince the retailer that they can do that and the market dynamics are right to do that, the retailer will sign up. And I do believe that both the Indian consumer and the Indian retailer do understand that those dynamics very well. And the third stakeholder, of course, is the loyalty management company. And the loyalty management company really plays the role of a bank and a guardian. So they need to maintain a completely independent status. They need to be able to treat all their retailers from an arm's length distance, not be partial to anybody. Make sure that each one is being catered to and added value to. And most importantly, all their investments that the retailers are putting into the program is resulting in an ROI. So essentially, it's teamwork. It's coming together to be able to. Somebody is more in an acquisition phase. Somebody is more in a retention phase. But they can all help each other given where the market is. So. A long answer to your question, but I think if you take care of these idiosyncrasies, you'll be able to make it work.
Since we're kind of running out of time, I just thought maybe you'd like to summarize, or would you like to take one last question? I leave it to the moderator. Yeah, so one last question. Anyone? Since there are no questions, maybe you'd like to summarize and.
Yeah.
One question, you've got one question.
Alright,
so just
yeah. Thank you. Like I said, it could go on. So then you would see more of us interested. Again, a lot of questions that would continue to ask, listen to. But what we tried to address here was that the data mining itself was a very large topic. And then we also, while we were preparing for the panel, we thought that data mining alone is not. Usually people discuss analysis, analytics, and data mining together. Data mining is a very advanced topic beyond analytics at some point. But how we heard from most of our panelists talk about how each of them uses data mining to get insights from the customers, from the quality customers or the companies. And we also saw how important data is. We also heard some of those use cases that people have done. And overall, thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for the great discussion that we had. Thank you so much for being here.